Thank you, returnees here. Thank you so much. You guys were here last time at the Nova presentation. I very much appreciate it. My name is Jerri Bergen, and I have a small little aviation art business, and that's what we do, is we do aircraft nose art and flight jackets. Now, unfortunately, there's way more flight jackets out there than there are aircraft, so that's actually what we do more of, is flight jackets. What I want to talk about today and get the opportunity to chat about is sort of the history of flight jackets and how it came to be that art was going to be so prominent on flight jackets in our military and civilian history. So I'm not going to go back to the prior slide that you saw, but I'll talk a little bit about history, how the flight jacket became a piece of our aviation uniform, and then what has inspired with that piece of equipment. So if you look at the aviator's uniform, if you just take any picture of a famous aviator, I will bet you on 10 to 1 you can find them in a flight jacket. You can find them in a leather jacket. And it becomes a ubiquitous symbol of an aviator in my mind, just in the pictures and the research that I have done. You go to this wonderful library behind us here in the Marsh Museum, and you pick up a book about a personality, an aviation personality. In most cases, you're going to find them in a flight jacket at some point, either on the cover of the book or inside the book itself. Here is a book of an autobiography written in part by Eddie Grickenbacher, an ace of World War I, one of the founders of Eastern Airlines, Medal of Honor recipient, I mean, amazing character, and a huge self-promoter, I might add. He was very good about getting out there in the public. But this painting that he had done of himself for the cover of this book, as you can see, he is in his greatcoat, which would have been one of the items he probably flew with while he was flying against the Germans in World War I. We just played this earlier, so there we go. You were talking earlier about Pancho Barnes, the socialite, born in 1916, I think, in South Pasadena, who was a true character in her own right. She was born Florence Barnes, wealthy family. She traded her tiara, however, for jokers in a flight jacket. She the socialite life and wanted to be in flying. She's one of the early powder puff racers. I know Jeff is going to give me a whole bunch of details about Pancho, but what I want to point out to you is that this was one of her favorite photographs of herself. She's got that very self-assured look. She's got her helmet on and that wonderful jacket. So I didn't want to point out who the aviator was in this photograph, but I thought you could probably do that. Anyone give a guess of who's the pilot in that picture?
Jimmy Doolittle.
It's actually Cap Arnold.
That's what I was
going to say. He was involved in a lot of testing of aircraft instruments and whatnot in the 1920s. He's wearing his knickers and Argyle socks for this particular flight test, but he's wearing also that flight jacket, surrounded by these members of the military and the government watchdog who is overseeing this flight testing. I thought that was hilarious, so he's an Argyle sock and a flight jacket. Mm-hmm. Now, it isn't also hard to pick out the aviator in this photograph, your famous aviator. Very tall, dapper man, always a lot of times flew in a business suit. You can see wearing that business suit underneath the leather jacket. That's the mayor of Chicago, and I think it's the one with the hat, the straw border hat. And this was when they were developing the mail routes across the United States. So he had a flight mechanic with him, the other man here in the jokers and the cap in his hand. Lindbergh is wearing his flight jacket. So I think I'm going to push a button and I'll just show you some other slides of the music of the types of individuals who were either pretend pilots or were real aviators, and you can see their attire. General goes around in an aviator's flight jacket. Okay, one of the most famous, if not one of the, gotcha, you know, that New Year's, what Jagger, what the glamorous planet to a mental deck giveaway, during his Navy, what, second? This is the, one of the, group of, astronauts testing for the Mercury space mission, for the next 16.
Carpenter, Cooper, Glenn, Grissom, Shirah, Shepard, and Deke Slayton.
Now, I do want to let you know before we go any further that in our presentation, we are talking about Noon Dark. We're talking about young men of the 40s. They are going to see some scantily clad young women. That's unnerving. I certainly want to make sure we're all good on that. Okay. Another actor with a huge boost to the leather jacket industry overall.
Steve McQueen.
Okay, now what guy in here is not at this point fantasized about being Tom Cruise? Tom Gunn. Lost the Lady is in the movie. He was in the white jacket and the basic uniform. And it wasn't just the great movie. It wasn't just the United States that this is a phenomenon, this is also international as well. Okay, and we can't forget our president. Right? George W. Bush was not in the Navy, where you do on here, but I understand he did fly for the Texas National Guard. His father, however, did fly in the Navy to continue his adventures. But there you see George Bush with flight jacket on. And they also see on the other side of the tent, Barack Obama in a New Hickman and Barnes A-2 jacket. If you want to appeal to the Air Force, what do you have to do? That's a put on a flight jacket. Why are leather jackets then so much a part of the aviator's history? One very good basic reason is it is for survival. In the beginnings of aircraft development, a lot of the aircraft were merely kites. These men are out in the elements, they're up in the air, it's bitingly cold, and they needed protection. That's a big reason why these big leather jackets became a necessary part of their uniform. Here we have Kill Devil Hill, where the Wright brothers are testing the Wright Flyer, and you know, people are bundled over. It's probably really, really breezy there, and he's all bundled up. This is an Italian monoplane. I apologize, I don't know the exact name of it. It's 1911, and you can see people around him are all bundled up. He's all bundled up in preparation for taking off a flight. And they're exposed to the elements. As you can see, there's no canopies of any kind. This is a reproduction. This gentleman is just stepping out. He's unbuttoning his coat. After the demonstration. This is a picture I took in Paso Robles. Chuck went for his day up there. They have a very rare reproduction up there. And it was 102 that day, and he was still all bundled up because, again, protection against the elements. That looks like a really scary ride, actually. This smoker here, big use of this airplane was in World War I. I love the ASCAP flying behind him. But without a canopy, without protection around them, they had to wear clothing that kept them warm, but possibly a little bit of protection against fire. And leather at the time was one of the only materials available to them that had given them some fire protection. Not much, but it gave them something better than cotton or linen or other materials. Now, after World War One, well, and even during World War One, there was advertisements out there about the kind of equipment that you could buy if you were going to go into the military, because your outerwear was not a military issue at the time. You had to bring it yourself. There is a Spalding jacket understand what you mean. I understand a spotting aviator, equipment jacket is a jacket like this one up here on the upper right, number three, if I remember right. And if you notice something about those jackets, that is pretty, standard, is that they have a big collar. And that wasn't really a fashion item. It was so they could bring the collar up and button it while there was a wind. Protect their wind from the icy, protect their neck from the icy winds and whatnot. It's also another reason why I had to ask about it. Help them in their rubbernecking looking for any aircraft and to keep their neck protected. But I love, you might not be able to read it from here, but number three, it says, in describing number three, the Spalding Aviation Equipment Company says, now worn by aviators of a European belligerent nation. I thought that was pretty good. Even our enemies are wearing these clothes. And Burberry on the right, if you're going to be, you know, if you're going to be an officer in the military, you've got to look good. And they're obviously saying that to the officers, you've got to look good. Did anyone see the movie Flatbush?
Yeah.
Did anyone think it was a fairly historic? I should ask Jeff. Is that historically accurate?
No, the flying part wasn't bad.
Yes.
I mean, some of the storylines was obviously Hollywood.
I thought so too. The painting, they did some painting of aircraft in that movie, which I thought how they probably would have done it. And the clothing that they wore, I thought was fairly accurate as well. And Jesse might have some additional information. So they're wearing the cavalry style Lafayette Escadrille uniform. And then over the top of that, you see that they have these different styles of leather jackets. There's two of them there. And then there's a close-up right out of the movie. You see they're all different, but they all had to bring their own, and they all have really wide lapels. Again, one of the features that was common for these jackets because of where they were using them. A lot of these manufacturers had already been making leather jackets for the motorcycle trade, for motorbikes and then cars that were now becoming more and more popular. So it's not like these jackets were impossible to find. If there was a whole industry starting out there with these kinds of jackets. After the war, leather still was in use for aviators, as a lot of these aircraft were getting more and more developed, and the race for technological advancement in aviation was on between the United States and all kinds of countries. These two gentlemen on the left are doing a balloon test in 1922, and they are about to get in the balloon and go to 20,000 feet, extremely high, and they're trying for an altitude record. And you can see how they're dressed here, head to toe in leather, all buttoned up. The gentleman on the right was a barnstormer, a pilot, a huge self-promoter, a racer. Roscoe Turner is his name, and a fabulous pilot, won several air racing trophies. But he had, I think of him as sort of the Liberace of that time. Flash, he was all about the bling, you know. He liked to look good while he was doing all of his stuff promoting his flying, and he was a fabulous pilot as well. Anyway, so he had this leather jacket made out of a lion's pelt, which you can see, and even the pocket, you see are the little paws, He was a sponsor of Gilmore Gasoline. Anyone familiar with Gilmore Gasoline? Gilmore Gasoline, and ironically, their mascot was a lion. And he actually carried this lion around with him in the airplane that had Gilmore. He had a Lockheed that he flew around, and the lion was named Gilmore, and he would bring it out to these promotional tours. And the lion had his own parachute even. But that coat just blows me away. Another gentleman that you're probably familiar with today had his start in World War I painting the characters, and that was Walt Disney. He was 16 years old and wanted to join the military in World War I, but he was too young, so he lied about his age. And he took the last boat over to England on a medical ship, and he was expected to be an ambulance driver. And this was, the armistice was signed, actually, when he was on the boat going over to Europe to help out. So the war was over. But he spent a year in Europe, running wounded men from hospital to hospital and in and out of the country. And on the side of his name, he had those characters that he would draw. Can you see those face in the canvas on his ambulance up there? Anyway, he was all these little characters. And he was also known for painting on flight jackets. Now, I've never seen a picture of one of these flight jackets. I've been searching. And in fact, I have a painting with the Disney Archives in a couple of weeks where I hope to go into their archives and see a picture of him and one of his flight jackets. But I have not yet gotten into it yet. But I'm looking forward to it. So he was painting flight jackets in World War One. Barnstorming became a huge entertainment venue after World War One. There were a lot of pilots now interested in aviation. There was pilots coming out of World War One that flew then. And barnstorming was really the traveling show of the early 1920s and into the 30s. And these young pilots, these daredevil pilots, would travel the country and across the country. They'd land in a field and they'd rustle up some rides, or maybe they do a little air show and they pick up a collection in the town and they move on to the next town. And how they make their money? That's under the wings and really gave people an amazing show. This gentleman, his name was Norman Locklear, Leslie Locklear, one of those pilots. And he was a daredevil beyond description. I just can't even imagine what this gentleman did, how he slept at night. But he did sounds like locking two jennies together, flying across an open space, and then the pilots would get out of their cockpit, walk across the wings, and switch airplanes. In flight. He would do things like you see here. They would have a passenger on the wing, and the passenger would change planes and go from one airplane to another. They would play tennis on the top of the wing. He'd fly, and two people, one on each end, actually looking like they were playing tennis. I mean, that blows you away. And he had a promoter that worked with him, and they thought they were really going to fleece the whole Midwest by staging these air shows. And he had a promoter named Pickens that would go ahead a town and rustle up business, you know, put up flyers, say, next Saturday we're going to Daredevil, you know, barnstormer here. And Locklear would show up in the jetty, and they would raise the money from one of the next town. Locklear actually died, unfortunately. He was invited by some Hollywood producers to movie, and he died in a night stunt, flying at night in 1931, I believe. He crashed while doing a stunt. But that's not surprising. I'm making you ask a little bit as long as he did. But the reason why I bring up Locklear is because I found his jacket, a picture of a jacket he used for that promotional purpose. And on the back of it here, this beautiful long three-quarter length leather jacket, it does say, Admiral Leslie Locklear, flying for the flying circus, the Pickens Flying Circus. So a good marketer himself, he's advertising for his flying skills on the back of his jacket. Now I saw this on eBay and it already sold as part of an estate collection. And I can't remember exactly how much it went for before I was able to put my hands on that. The military, the Air Corps, the Army, I should say specifically, didn't have any specifications for flight jackets through World War One, and they were noodling around with jackets, and they finally came up with this design called the A-1 in 1927. And Jeff, you know, I'm wrong. You're coming up here. And it had buttons, you see it had a close-fit collar, and it had the cotton sleeve and the cotton waistband. And the reason for that is they needed to get in and out of a cockpit quickly. They needed to have long sleeves and some protection for warmth. And another reason that the Army designed the jacket this way is they made it very smart because they wanted their pilots to look professional, or their professional powder gear. And there's no side pockets on the early A-2. And the reason is they didn't want their officers standing out their hands. So they had top entry pockets on the side into pockets. Well, there was a big revolution in the textile industry in 1929. Anyone tell me what that big revolution was? Ginormous, changing industry forever. The machine was a little earlier, but that did certainly help. It was the zipper. this one was designed, or was invented, in, I think, 1828 or 1829. And when the A-2 did actually finally come out and officially into the service in 1930, it came out with a zipper. As you can see, this gentleman is here behind me demonstrating the initial A-2 as it was issued in 1930. Sorry, this is 1930, but that's, the jacket didn't change from 1930, so this gentleman had it in 1942. So what's the kind of art do you see on jackets a lot of times? Most often, what I've seen, and Jessica maybe helped me out too, is squadron insignia. That's the most common kind of art you're ever going to find on a flight jacket. And that's because that's really the identifier for that individual and what unit he belonged to. And why did squadron insignia, why was that so common? Well, it all, in my mind, it all goes back to the heraldry and the identification of the military, which started way back in the Middle Ages, back when knights were on a field, and the only way to identify friend and foe was by your coat on and by the colors you wore, the banners, the color of the banners that were over your head. And the tradition of having a coat on has been instituted in our military since the Middle Ages. And the squadron insignia was a big element of artwork on aircraft. As you can see here, Rickenbacker again. With the insignia for the 94th Aero Squadron, the hat and the ring. One of the first aviation units in the Army, in the U.S. Army, the hat and ring stood for the United States finally getting into the war. So they designed this little unit, logo called hat in the ring. And I should have pointed out to you, but that young man in the front of the T-38, he was in the 94th Aero Squadron, and his logo on his jacket was the 94th Aero. So when you see patches on jackets, it's all about the squadrons and the units that they served with. Here's a picture I found of some Navy pilots, Marine pilots, excuse me, in 1931. And they all have their squadron insignia stuck on the back right in the middle, but it identifies them as a group. You know, this is their letterman's jacket, so to speak, and they're all in this together, the same insignia. So the patches that you could find on jackets and otherwise are all different sizes, all different styles and whatnot. And the reason for that is that squadron insignia are the responsibility of the squadrons themselves. They are not designed by the commanding officers, they're designed by the units themselves, and they're responsible to actually go to serve them themselves, too. They had to get approval for the design, but after that, they went to die themselves. So in World War II in particular, knowing where the unit was stationed could tell you a lot about how they had, were going to have their patches made. In England, for example, they had access to some phenomenal leather artists. And so they would get artists, they would get patches made, like you see over here. These are CGI patches, however, but you see those tooled leather, where the pieces of leather sewn on to make a patch. You can see styles like that. In other areas where they had access to towns that had embroidery available, you can see patches that were embroidered or bullion. Just an amazing variety of patch styles, simply because the guys had to go make them themselves and they used whatever resources were around. And here's just some of those examples. Now, what, in addition to squadron insignia, did you see as artwork on jackets? Well, a big part of the artwork we saw in World War II was the artwork on the aircraft themselves, which is nose art. And there was just a plethora of nose art on aircraft. And a lot of it has to do with just the sheer number of aircraft that were built for World War II for this conflict. There was over 400,000 airplanes built for the World War II effort, and there are estimates that maybe 80-90% of those aircraft had nose art on them of some kind. And about half of that nose art was a character, like you see Bugs Bunny up there, or Chief Mask here, or maybe just a name, like George Bush had Barbara written on the side of his team manager. But in most cases, it was a girl, right? You got young guys, they have nothing to do, they got 6 hours to kill, or maybe they don't. And what do they think about? They think about a young gal back home or something to that effect. So, a lot of the artwork turned out to be these young ladies. And another thing that I really enjoy about nose art when I do the study notes is that a lot of times there's a message in the nose art. There's a story. They took that girl for a reason, or they're telling you something in the nose art. And so when you look at a piece of nose art, you always have to wonder, what were they thinking? In this particular case, I'll show you this down here. I just saw this presentation before, saw this. It's this beautifully endowed young lady, new, and she's sitting on a live bomb that's about to go off. And she's got her ears plugged. She's ready for this event, right? She doesn't have an issue. And the text says, sure pop, which in lingo is, in that time, I understand, meant no problem. She's good with all this. To the left of her is a V, which is a good luck charm, meaning victory, right? And then there's a dot, 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 and a dash, which is Morse code for another V symbol. So they have two lucky charms in this piece of artwork, the two V for victory. So they're going to come home safe if they've got the lucky charm painted on the nose of their earphone. So I've got a couple of slides here. We'll just show you the amazing variety of nose art you're going to see on these earphones.
One of them,
it's all really an inspiration about, Ozone and Alberta Water.
So you included, Senate that would come out in magazine, in this magazine that went to all the war theaters, and you included same girl show up on all these different aircraft. So it kind of gave you the reference material for these young soldiers. Now the jacket you see that, young man wearing, it's not a leather A-2, it's the next evolution of the flight jet. We'll talk about that in a second. The jacket, in addition to having artwork, would also become the scorecard for the crew. Anyone ever hear that phrase, Umbriago? Umbriago. From Jimmy Durante. He was a comic, an actor in the 1940s, and he was big Italian. He was famous for his nose. His schnoz, he called it. It's just ginormous. Anyway, I digress here. But anyway, a lot of athletes were called Umbriago because of this show that Jimmy Durante had that he used to say all the time. But what the crew would do, and in this case, you can see that the entire crew would put the artwork of their aircraft on the back of their jacket. And in that artwork, along with the name or the artwork, they would include the mission. Here they got 8, because they were in the 8th Air Force, and they would have those bombs painted on the jacket to tell the battalion how many missions this particular crew did. Jeff, you have some amazing samples of original World War II jackets up here. You want to talk about those?
Sure.
You see these two jackets here. They're just a couple of the collections that the March Museum has. So these are original. Jeff's going to give us more details about them. I can see no side pockets, right? It's the regulation cut. One of the things that you see on there is the leather strip. I understand that officers were given 6 strips. You see how worn they became? And so when it wore off, they didn't have the correct position anymore. They just pulled them out of the pocket and put another one on. Here's your desk.
We have 2 out of our collection that are here displayed today. One is the Betty J. Now, the Betty J belongs to a captain shop. Captain Schott turned out, he stayed in the military after World War II and became a lieutenant general. He was commander of the 15th Air Force at Marshfield in 1978 when he retired. And to see it, that the aircraft's name, Betty J, was named after his girlfriend at the time, Betty Jean. And she turned out to be, they turned out to be quite a couple. They stayed married for 65 years. If you see, we've got some pictures, I don't know if they're in your presentation or not, but we do have some pictures of the aircraft itself with Betty J painted on the side and the other members of the crew, all wearing the same sort of, the same design on the back that identifies them to that particular aircraft. The bombs that you see here are all the missions that they perform. So every time they fly a successful mission, they paint a bomb on it. You'll see there's a lot of different things in the different jackets as you look. They'll show different symbols, maybe a bomb in the hull, we have one jacket on our display. That the aircraft and the crewmen that wore that particular jacket did 31 missions. The 31st mission of the aircraft was badly shot up and had landed an emergency airstrip in England on its way back to its main aerodrome, and it never flew again. It was completely destroyed. So when they painted that 31st bomb symbol on its jacket, they did a little hollow outline saying that, you know, we made the mission, we did what we were supposed to, but we didn't make it all the way home. So they all mean different things. Now the general, the important part on A2s, of course, is the zippers themselves. You can always tell a real A2 by the American zipper. Don't let anybody ever try to convince you that a Taiwanese-made zipper is an original World War II jacket. The other ones, there are always the pockets. If it has pockets on the back, it's not a World War II one. The lining, because there were so many different companies that made A2s, you really can't tell from the leather itself as to whether it's original, except, of course, due to its aging. But look at the lining. If the lining is polyester, then it's not an original. Any Army Air Force jackets that were made have polished cotton linings. So they're very distinctive in that. They can be 100 different shades. It all depends on that. So that's a key that you want to look for in these in order to determine whether you have one that's an original or not. Now our second jacket is a much better example. And you'll notice, anybody see what's wrong with this particular jacket? I don't know, you guys are all tuned to A2s, know exactly how they are now. Notice his name tag.
Okay.
You know, that this is an add-on. After the war, the individual that owned this jacket put it on there to show that this is mine. And I believe he did this just before he donated to the museum to make sure that his name would stay forever. He did not have confidence that we would appropriately label it. We should have been perfectly calm. We were going to do it, but he'll say he had quite a career in the Army Air Force during the Second World War. You'll notice on his right shoulder, he's got an American flag. It was reasonably common, not as common as a squadron patch, but you do see them. And on his other shoulder, it's very faint, but you can see the 15th Air Force emblem painted directly on his 11. So this immediately identifies him. You can tell he's a D-17 crewman from the 15th Air Force that flew out of North Africa and Italy during the Second World War. The second half of the major campaign against the Germans, the first part of it, of course, came out of England, the 15th Air Force, and the second part was the 15th Air Force out of North Africa and Italy. On the back, you see his aircraft, the D-17, and the name of the aircraft here. Strangely enough, it's Virgil Virgins. Now, he claimed it when he donated his jacket that they were given the name because none of them had any combat experience when they went in. So they were a virgin to combat. And you'll notice around the edges, what he's done is he's printed out every mission they went on, where the targets were. So you can see that by the time he was done, by the time he finished his 35 missions, he was no longer a virgin. He had been everywhere and in some of the toughest campaigns. Quite the Kowalski list at the top. Some of the roughest bombing missions of the entire Second World War. A-2s, and I know Jerry's doing an excellent job of explaining this, but A-2s are a way to announce to all of the people that you come up against who you are and where you fit. They're the ultimate way of showing that you are better. Many veterans, of course, you have your rivets, combat rivets, and campaign rivets to show where you've been and what you've done. But for any leader in the Second World War, the way to prove that and to show who you were and what you've done is to put it right in your jacket so that when you met someone, you knew exactly what level of experience they had and what their background was.
I think the one here says butterflies, the captain's cards on the top, is that right? Yes. I noticed, can you tell us a little bit, sometimes they changed their mind, didn't they?
You generally will not see any rank insignia on the ones that were issued to enlisted men. It's reasonably common on officers' jackets for a number of reasons. The number one being officers like that everybody knows that they're an officer. That's it. And the other one is that it's much easier to do. It's difficult to paint a set of stripes on a jacket that's going to really last and hold up to it, but an officer's insignia on the shoulders is relatively easy. You'll see it in a couple of different ways. Either a piece of leather that's been painted and then applied to the jacket itself. Sometimes you'll find them directly painted right on the epaulet itself. And you will occasionally find them embroidered. You'll see bullion insignias that are embroidered and placed on the jackets. Now, not everybody did this, but it was a relatively common thing. And that is another way to tell whether you're dealing with a real jacket or not. Of course, we have a real key to JP2 jackets, and that works for almost all U.S. military supplies. You can put that in the back of your mind, is that if it says made in the USA, it's not real. Because nothing that was ever done on a government contract is ever marked made in the USA. It's just assumed, of course, that it is. So if you see one that said that, it isn't.
Thank you very much, Joe.
I remember reading about the instigation of the A-2 jacket. The initial contract requirements of the A-2 company had a horse hide. And the reason why horse hide was chosen was that it was the most plentiful leather at the time. In the 1930s, the horse and buggy was fast becoming a lost way of travel, and cars were the most common way of travel. And so horses were becoming very obsolete for travel purposes, and they were very plentiful. People were selling them off, you know, for dirt cheap, and horse hide was the predominant leather. Now, during World War II, leather became very scarce, and they went to goat skin and cow hide and a bunch of other types of leathers, but the initial issue requirement was horse hide. So as Jeff mentioned, just like with the Betty J, you can identify a crew member by the artwork on the back of his jacket, because most times it matched the artwork he might have had on their plane. So here's Miss Lady on the B-24 with the missions underneath. And let's see, Times Awaken, same thing. What you can't read from probably your position up there, but in those 30 bombs on the top, he has spelled out European Theater of Operation. So kind of interesting how they got another little message inside his ball markings up there on the top. But another example of this marauder named Booger Red, too. The gentleman, the pilot, was from North Carolina and had the airplane named after this book sale. You see, you can turn the other direction. You know, you're facing one way and that. Good artwork. So the artwork that you're seeing on these jackets varies. Just like on the squadron package, it's dependent on where you were at. Some jackets have beautiful, beautiful artwork. And as I mentioned before, the 15th Air Force, the forces that were stationed in Italy did have a lot of stunning artwork done on jackets because they had access to artists right inside town. Whereas you might be on the South Pacific Islands, and we wouldn't wear much of a jacket anyway, but if you did, you might not have the same quality of art. Now, members, soldiers on the base would also sometimes do artwork for a fee. There's a gentleman I talked to that did artwork on jackets, and he sometimes charged guys up to $30 a jacket. Now, I understand $30 was a month's pay, and so he could get that much for paying on a jacket. And the guy was then sending money home. In fact, he was sending money home. In fact, he was sending so much money home that his commanding officer was considered a court martial because they thought he was gambling. But he wasn't, he was actually just going to put a $1 million in a jacket. They could make a lot of money. This little guy is just an example of how squadron patches were designed. This guy is Andy the Bulldog, and he was a stray that a group found on a base in southern England. And this is Lieutenant Tomlinson, who flew P-38s at the time, and he picked up the little guy and decided to take him with him, and they were transferred to a base in France. So he put the little bulldog on his shoulder, and the little guy was only 15 years old or so, and the little guy rode on the shoulder of the P-38 over to their new base in France. Well, he grew up, he became a nice, stout little guy there, and he became the mascot of the unit. And subsequently, after becoming the mascot of the unit, they designed their patch to look very much like the artwork that Lieutenant Tomlinson had on his race back here in T-47. So you see Andy is there as their squadron's mascot. We lost Lieutenant Tomlinson in a combat shortly after he had his aircraft painted, but they did have the squadron logo approved using Andy the Bulldog as their insignia. You can see how something came about. We had mentioned Disney earlier, Walt Disney. We talked about this in our Noah's Ark presentation, but Disney was also a big creator of squadron insignia. Remember, these guys had to come up with a design of their own, and many times they would contact the Disney studios, and Disney would design it for them at no charge. They'd tell them what unit they were with, and he or his artist would design something and send it back in the mail for them, and then they'd have their practice name. So that was fairly common. So you'll see a lot of Disney characters as squadron insignia. A lot of songs of the day made for nose art and jacket art. I think I put the song in here, but this is the song. You can see on the back of these guys' jackets, the B-17, and you can see the text there, Cisco Pat and Mom. Anybody remember that song?
Nope.
I think I had it for a few.
Lay that pistol down, oh, drinking beer in a cabaret, was I having fun, until one night she caught me right, now I'm off the run.
Oh, lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down, pistol
down. So you see, very similar to the same gals getting across, getting on aircraft across the war theater, you see the same names on airplanes, for that similar reason, the song would come out into the war theater. And soldiers would use that song as a method to name their own. So here's another one, another version, same concept of Shusha Baby. This might be a song. I actually put the, it came from a little bit of a movie clip, so I'll show you that as well.
Thank you.
Here's a little propaganda there. Not the original lyrics, but it's not what it's saying. So, you're getting an idea of what the original material that was used to create artwork on both jackets and on the aircraft that these young men were flying in World War II. And I'm just showing you a couple of different examples, very similar to Jeff's jackets that we've got here in the museum, but of the variety of things you can see on these A-2 jackets. This gentleman right here has patches on both sides, left and right chest. The custom is that you put your current insignia, your current squadron on your left, and if you have a patch insignia, that say you've been moved to another unit, you put your patch unit on your right. Another option would be to put maybe your squadron on your left, or you put the bomber over the larger unit on your right. So you can see both of those scenarios. You see he has one left and right. I just love this artwork, beautifully done. And a Barger girl, definitely a Barger girl. Another Barger girl, little Willie. And I can't make out the little text on the upper right, but you see next to the knockout drop, you see there's this little line of text on the top right there, and that's very similar to what Jeff showed you on this jacket, where these outfits define what mission they've gone on, where they actually bombed. On the top of the jacket here. Very simple, aces and eights, that's a card. And there's the Andy jacket. You notice the whistle on the jacket there. That was not a government issue in the American side, but I understand in the RAF, you were issued an emergency whistle. In case you were down in the water or something, you could make noise and be rescued. I understand this is a hot souvenir item. Americans like that idea, and so they swap the RAF titles for something to get a whistle, or they go get their own. The uninvited. He has 26 bomb markings, mission markings, and in the little card that the skeleton is holding in his hand, it says Beneath 32. So maybe he just didn't have the rest of the bombs, or maybe that's the message here that he didn't have 32 missions. So just, I see this artwork and I'm just amazed at the ingenuity and the imagination of these guys and the scorecard that it represented. This is a beanie jacket that he won from the AUG Theater. 23rd Fighters Squadron? No, 75th. Anyway, I know that this is in the Wright Patton Museum, a beautiful piece of artwork. And the colors on that just blow me away. The type of paint that was used really did determine if the artwork was going to stay on the jacket. Jackets were initially built or manufactured with a tanning process, a vegetable tanning process. It wasn't silicone, artificial embedding of color like they do today. It was a big tub of colorant made from vegetable material that the leather was poured in, and that's how the color of the jacket turned out. Is that correct, Jeff? Something like that? And so the coloring would actually fade quite quickly. You know, you could scratch it and color on the original jacket. It came off pretty darn easy. Today, it's like bulletproof. The color doesn't come off easy at all. So seeing color like that on a jacket is just stunning because it wore off so quickly. This is a mission scorecard that you'd really be proud of, wouldn't you? The tech sergeant served in both the European and Pacific theater. And that is quite a scorecard. And I can see what Jeff is saying, you know, you'd be proud of that in the bar, right? They'd know exactly the things you'd accomplished here. The battleship he shot, he was an ace. He's got five Japanese battle flags on their top. I think there's 60-some missions. No, I think that's what he's doing. No, there's more than 60-some. But you can just get an idea of the amazing track record of this young man. Jackets, in some cases, in some units, they use them as a show of appreciation. This particular unit, you know, on a base in England, were very appreciative of the young ladies that served them coffee and donuts, the American Red Cross girls. And these young girls had a booth and coffee trucks on a lot of bases, and their job was actually just to serve
coffee and had a smile for these young men either before or after they were going out on a mission. And so this entire crew opted and voted to actually recognize the service of these young ladies, the American Red Cross, by representing one named Bertie Schmidt was her name. And so they actually painted her likeness on the side of the airplane and then named her aircraft Bertie Schmidt. And here's another picture of the front of them, and there she is standing in the middle of them. And I want to say thank you to these girls for their service. I think we know you. So the A-2 was canceled in 1940, the letter I-2, I should say, was canceled in 1943 simply because they ran out of material. There was just not enough leather to keep up with the demand. As I mentioned, they went from horse hide to cow hide to goatskin, and they just ran out. And it was Hat Arnold, I understand, who made the statement, we should be making these jackets out of a factory, not a pasture. And so he mandated that the fabric go to a textile. And they did. You know, regardless of the burning factors, et cetera, that's what they decided to do. And so it turned into the B-10. Which they changed it to a mouton, a fur collar, and everything else remained the same, but it was made of canvas and had a little bit of fill. And you can see there was still some artwork that we found here, but you can hardly find these jackets anymore because they deteriorated so fast. The cotton material just didn't last for 70 years like some leathers have. Jeff, do you have any in the collection, any cotton?
None with any appreciable artwork on them.
Okay. Yeah, these are really, really rare, actually. Here's another example. The B-10 still had artwork on it and could still be used as a scorecard, as Jeff pointed out, but because of the material themselves, you just don't see them around a whole lot. You see artwork on other types of jackets besides A-2s. I've got here's an Army Field jacket here on the left, and this is just an Army overshirt that you see on the right side there. From a B-17, a tail gunner. If anyone know Wilbur Richardson from Champlain Defense, this is actually his. I actually took a picture of it and said, Wilbur, let me have that for a little bit. And what you see on his, on this little cotton overshirt, he listed the 32 missions, and very similar to the jacket Jeff pointed out here. In some of those missions, he'd actually point out where they were going, and in one of them, they had to parachute out. So you see one of the bombs has a parachute on it because they had to eject because the airplane was going down. They managed to recover the airplane, but most of the crew got out and the pilot saved the airplane. And then on the last one in Munich, he was wounded, so he put a little Purple Heart on that particular mission. Yeah, like Jeff was saying, it gives a real story of where he was. This jacket on the left is on the field jacket of a glider pilot. After a while, the B-10 morphed into the B-15, which had synthetic materials now. It was made with a mix of a more fire-retardant material. And you can see the design has changed quite considerably, more closer to the modern jacket, flight jacket that is issued today. It's got slash pockets. It's got a pen holder in the front. It's got a pen holder on the side and a zipper holder on the side so that the pilots could reach something and they didn't have to dig down the cockpit. They could actually get something near their shoulders. And this was a Korean era in 1951, jacket edition 1951. You can see it doesn't paint it up or fine, but just like the situation with the cotton jacket, these are also very, very rare. Now, you were telling me, Jeff, that your dad had a leather jacket and had it painted in Vietnam.
Of his Vietnam aircraft he had done after the World
War. Oh, that's right. So, but he had those there on the airplane, and then he got a jacket later and had the artwork painted on. And it's up here. I'm going to show it here in a second. So, what you could most often see after World War II, you would see jackets in World War II, and these were actually because there were still warehouses of some jackets, and they would issue them as long as they had some. But most often, what you would find is the guys who would go out and buy their own jackets, they'd get these party suits, they'd call them, I understand, where they'd go to a local village in the Korean or Vietnam conflict and have something embroidered. That was far more common and lasted longer, too. So they'd go down and give $20, and 3 days later, they'd come back in the back of the jacket and have some amazing design embroidered on it. Here's a couple examples here.
anybody have one of these, by the way? These also are really, really rare as well. Do you have any of these in that, Jeff?
We have some party shirts, but we don't have any specific jackets. They're often called cruise jackets.
Cruise jackets, yes, thank you.
They're out there, they're still floating around. Most of these are sent out some of these closets.
Yeah. Now, we can't talk about that, but that is another reason why I have thoroughly enjoyed being in this business, because I get to help people save a little bit of history. I can't tell you how many times someone has come up to me and said, you know, my dad came home from World War II and he used his A-2 jacket to stuff a hole in the plumbing. You know, he didn't want to think about the war, he just wanted to get behind him. And God, I missed my dad's jacket because now I want to remember him and what he did. And so we'll make a reproduction jacket. He said, yeah, he had this on the shoulder, had this on the front, and this on the back. And so we'll create another one. Because that first jacket, you know, they didn't want to have that jacket. They didn't want to be reminded of what they'd just gone through, which is totally understandable. A lot of instances, this happened to my own father-in-law. I guess when you're processed out, you're told to put, one of the processes is you get up on a bus, you go into a depot, you have to put your duffel bag and everything down, you go in, you take signs and papers as part of your processing out procedure. A lot of their equipment was stolen. They described that there was actual thievery rings where, you know, they knew that they were going to have to put something else down on a bus, and they come back and the jacket would be gone. The valuable stuff would just be taken away. And several people last come in contact with, that's exactly what happened. They want to bring their jacket home, but it was gone. So you can see why they wanted to save it. So the VC team does morph. In the middle of the 1960s, it morphed again to the MA-1, which is very close to the jacket you'll see today, the standard flight jacket, the standard issue Nomad flight jacket. They're green. They're flight, they have that plain retardant material, and the interior of them is a bright orange for emergency. You can turn this light out and wear it for visibility if you're shot down, for example. You see, this is Alan Shepard, I believe, who was on a test, a moon landing test procedure where they're practicing the equipment to pick up rocks, and he's got his on inside out, as you can see there. The patches are put all over, as you can see, and patchwork was much more common, as you can see on this particular jacket. There's no painting at any time, but he had several patches that he put on for his flight, but in various units. The Navy, we've been talking about the Army Air Corps and the Air Force all this time, but the Navy stuck with the G1 pretty much. You know, the Air Force went through these various changes on the design of their jacket, but the Navy still today is still issuing the G1, from what I understand, which is a slightly different design, and I don't think I brought a G1. Their jackets are very similar, but they always have the mouton fur collar. They have swing wings. The back is designed a little bit differently. Do they have side entry pockets?
Some of them do. The more ones, the biggest thing, they have buttons.
And they have buttons instead of snaps. Yeah, you're right. And they have a big flap on the interior that says U.S. Navy. Yeah. So they're still using those as the Navy Day unit example. These Corsair pilots and their patch. The Navy has never allowed personal markings on their jackets. Some people get away with it. Continued laundering insignia are acceptable, but not personal paintings of any kind. You were telling me, Jeff, that there is a regulation that said no markings on jackets. That was an Army regulation, is that right?
In 1944.
Yeah, we saw that out on the list. I wasn't aware of that, but you can see how they officially regard that. And you saw jackets painted all the time. So, and they didn't enforce it very well. The collectors today, and since the early 80s, are absolutely agog for these jackets. Some of these jackets go for easily $10,000 to $12,000 for a jacket in its original condition from World War II. There was a guy, and he was the band manager for the Pretenders. You know the band Pretenders. I can't remember what his name was, but in the early 1980s, he was obsessed with getting jackets. From what I understand, I know a friend of his, he had an entire warehouse full of just painted A2 jackets. He'd go to garage sales, he'd go to gun shows, he'd go and
take a look at, you know, antique ones to find these. And he, this man single-handedly drove the price up in the 1980s, to where he could get it for $25 or $30, up to now, well, it has ebbed and flowed. I'd say today, still an original one is still probably about $3,000 or $4,000 if you found one. Does that sound about right?
You can find an original A-2 painted jacket. Yeah, three or four minimum,
yeah. But he ratcheted the price up a lot. It dropped a little, and I think it's going to go back up now. So these are very much collector's items. We've had a couple of people come to us with original jackets and say, hey, can you touch this up and make it look nice and free for our dad? And we'll, you know, we will not forget. The history of that jacket is far too important. And so we've made reproduction jackets, or we've created the artwork again on a separate jacket. But we certainly don't ever want to change an original jacket. The guy that also did a bunch for the A-2 jacket was Steve McQueen. He was the quintessential A-2 jacket wearing guy. And in two of his movies, The War Lover and The Great Escape, he is wearing that jacket a lot. There's other guys that wear jackets a lot in movies. We saw for Top Gun and John Wayne, Hogan's Heroes, right? He wore his jacket all the time. They do not. So, but the reason why this Steve McQueen is on for is that the Japanese think he walks on water. Or if anyone's been in Japan, you might have seen a store that they have there called the Buzz Brickman Leather Goods Store. And Buzz Brickman is the character of Steve McQueen in The Great Escape. Or no, yeah, The Great Escape. Remember The War Lover? Did I say the wrong one? The War Lover. Okay, so they actually created a store named after Steve McQueen's character in The War Lover. And it's a high-end leather store. And you can see, here's one of their models demonstrating one of the jackets there. It's a big craze in Japan to have a light jacket. As we mentioned, that the A2 jacket and the leather style was out of stock by the mid-1940s, during World War II. It has since been reissued to active military Air Force guys as of 1988. And we have a gentleman that brought one in today. Thank you. Thank you for bringing the jacket. It's actually right here. So I appreciate that we came to this one here. There are some requirements, though, that the U.S. government has put on these new A2 jackets that are being issued. They have to be, the material also has to be supplied with the United States. So as you said, Jeff, if it says made in the USA, you know you don't have a real one. Right? And there's no marks allowed at all on the jacket. And no patches are allowed to be sewn directly to the jacket. And you brought that great reason up. The reason why is if you're in flight and you're going to go down into enemy territory, you have to take those patches off, right? Chuck them out the window or something. You're not supposed to go down with your identifiers on them. No, actually, that might be a reason why the paint or the art on the jacket might be the official reason, huh? Because you can't take it off.
Sort of. The official reason was that the military hasn't changed a great deal since the Second World War, as far as that goes. It's very unmilitary looking to paint these things under jacket.
Oh.
So, in order to be conformed.
Yes.
A-2 jackets have never been popular with the management side, I'll put it that way.
Okay. Got it. So, what we do a lot in Victory Girl, what we do a lot of is somebody will give us their jacket after they retire, and we'll paint something on it, because they do want to remember, they do want to have their scorecard on there. Or they'll ask us to paint a similar jacket and make a reproduction for them. This is Lucky Lopez, a gentleman that flew in a Desert Storm as a jacket gun. Help me out here.
A-10.
A-10, Warhawk. He flew Warhawks and wanted to remember his service, and so we painted his artwork on the side of his airplane here. As she goes on his jacket. And so today, we were painting jackets today. It's all about a particular message that somebody wants to get across, or the conversation that they want to have in the bar that night because they're wearing their jacket. And so I just have something I want to show you, and then we'll be able to wrap it up and ask some questions. Let's see what we can find here. This young man should have been born 60 years ago. He asked me to paint his B3 Shearling with some artwork that his grandfather flew in World War II, in the 100th bomber. This gentleman was writing a book about Buddy Holly and about Buddy Holly's last flight before he was killed in an airplane crash. And so he toured the United States with this car that he had made and his jacket in various shows to promote his book, so he had a jacket for him. This young man, this 16-year-old young man, was very proud of his grandpa's service. And so he had his jacket, his 16-year-old, painted with artwork so he could remember his grandpa. I thought that was a really neat idea. He wore this to school, so he could talk about his grandpa. This this amazing roadster won several awards at the Mono Valley Roadster Show in January, just 2 years ago. They put the car on a truck, and Chick, who's the guy that built the roadster, went in to pay a bill and stole the car was stolen right off the trailer, and all he had left was his jacket, unfortunately. So we painted the jacket for him to go to the car shows with it, and the car show.
Overseas.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. This is a pilot currently where we did a reproduction jacket for an active pilot today. And the funny thing about this particular jacket is you see the aircraft on the right side, there's a T-45, there's a 757, there's a tanker there. But these are the type of aircraft he's racing. And he said, make sure you need room because I need a tank rating for a couple more. So he's going to come back and we're going to put those other aircraft on there for him. And this gentleman is on our field at Cable Air Force, and he got his pilot's license at the tender age of 76. And he's so proud of that fact that he finally got his pilot's license at 76. So he wears his jacket around so that he can have conversations with people about being a pilot. Okay, so this is my last slide, I think. Thank you for your time. I do have a jacket I painted up here just recently, this one on the right, way back there with a T-51 on it. This is a lot of the kind of jacket that we're doing today. I'm delivering this to a gentleman who's from Sweden, and he came to Kissimmee, Florida for a P-51 flight. You know, we can sit in the back of TS-51. He loved the flight. He had a fabulous time. It's all he talked about for his whole holiday. He got on the ground, and his family got in the car and whatnot, and they left. His camera equipment and everything was stolen. All of the bags were stolen and everything. I don't think we feel bad being American. This was like last year. They're coming back this year, and the only picture he had of that flight that he just loved so much was the flight of the other guy. You know, they do the mock shot fight. That guy took a picture of him and sent it to him in Sweden. So he had me take that picture and put it on the back of his jacket because that's the only memory he has now of that flight. So anyway, thank you for your time. I'll put on this little slideshow, and if we have any questions, we'll talk about them. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.